This is the Smallmouth Crush Podcast Season 2. If you're a hardcore angler, you've come to the right place. This podcast that will interview some of the top local and regional anglers in North America. Anglers who consistently finish near the top in both largemouth and smallmouth bass fishing tournaments. Travis and his guest will discuss techniques and strategies used to help these anglers stay so consistent and help you become a better angler and gain an edge on your body of water. And now, here's your host of the Smallmouth Crush Podcast, Travis Manson.
Hello, welcome to the Smallmouth Crush Podcast. My name is Travis Manson. Here we are. We are officially into season two of the Smallmouth Crush Podcast. I want to thank Dave Mercer for wrapping the season up last week, and we made it. It's been a journey. So we're going to have some great information, definitely moving forward. And so for season two, it's talking with some of the local and regional anglers when it comes to both largemouth, smallmouth, spotted bass across the country. A little different theme, although today's podcast, you wouldn't think it is. We have our guest could have easily have been part of the season one, some of the top smallmouth anglers across the country. Mike definitely fits into that category, and I can't wait to hear some of his stories up on Lake Erie. So I've already started recording for season two. So next week, Sunday, we're going to head down to Lake of the Ozarks and talk largemouth fishing down there. And there's going to be some great information moving forward. The only problem, don't hate me, it's every other week. So it's going to be on Sundays. It'll come out on the YouTube channel, Smallmouth Crush, as well as all the podcast platforms. But it will be an every other week show. So just keep that in mind. We're still going to have a lot of great content on the YouTube channel. I encourage you guys to head on over there. Definitely subscribe if you haven't. You can follow me on Instagram as well at Smallmouth Crush. And we're going to kick this season off right. But before we go there, let's talk about, of course, the Real Shot. You guys know the drill by now. All kinds of bass tackle, walleye, salmon, trout, whatever. Panfish, ice fishing, I don't know, hunting. They got it all over at the Real Shot, therealshot.com. Take advantage of my code. Seriously, Smallmouth Crush 15. If you're going to buy some baits, I know if you're listening to this podcast, you're buying some baits. And there's been a lot of great tips, a lot of great techniques, and a lot of great tackle that these guys are talking about. And before you go anywhere else, head on over to the Real Shot. See if they got any of this stuff in stock. See what they have. Same day shipping. Again, 15% off your first order. Can't go wrong. Smallmouth Crush 15. And let's bring Mike in. Mike, how are you doing?
Hey, doing great, Travis. How are you?
Good. I mentioned in the beginning, you easily could have qualified to be part of the season one of the top smallmouth guys out there. I know that's one of your passions, but judging by all those deer behind you and ducks and waterfowl, I think you like to hunt a little bit too.
You know what? I have two passions in life. One is hunting, and the number one is fishing. So this time of year, it's a super big struggle for me. This is a tremendous time to do both. You know, of course, deer hunting's happening and we're having a blast with that. And I smallmouth fish pretty much if the water is not hard, I'm out there. So you can imagine how this last 2 weeks here with deer hunting, it's been a little bit of a struggle.
No, I can imagine. Before we get into it, because I'm going to have a bunch of questions, I really want to pick your brain when it comes to fishing tournaments and the bodies of water that you fish, all the little secrets, if we can pull out of you, that makes you such a successful angler. But before we go there, if you could take a moment, briefly introduce yourself and let everyone know what part of the country you're from, some of the bodies of water that you fish, and basically what you're up to when it comes to fishing.
Absolutely. So, of course, my name's Mike Trombley. I am from Belleville, Michigan. I'm originally from Perrysburg, Ohio. So basically my home waters would be anywhere from the Bass Islands of the Western Basin of Lake Erie to St. Clair. Of course, I fish up north, northern Michigan, and fish some FLW stuff, you know, out East Coast way. So kind of been a little bit everywhere. Champlain, Thousand Islands, Buffalo. Just all those phenomenal fisheries. And I kind of started when I was, oh gosh, probably 1991, fishing with my Uncle Tom, my late Uncle Tom. It just kind of sparked the smallmouth bug for me. And it's been a passion ever since. It's a blast. The things that we've seen over the last 30 years, it's hard to describe how things have changed. You know, we started off, it was pre-GPS. And of course, we had a Lurian C starting off. That was a huge increase in what we could do. And then when GPS took off, oh my gosh. And, you know, it's just been a snowball of new technology. It's a wonder what's going to happen in the next 10 years.
I know. How did we fish back then? I don't even, you know, today it feels kind of even foreign just looking at a 2D anymore up front.
Yeah, it really is.
We rely on that all the time.
It has its place for sure.
Absolutely. And I definitely want to talk to you about electronics and some of the different ways that you utilize them when you're out there on big bodies of water. You mentioned you've been all over the country chasing these fish. What would be a place you just love to go to?
My favorite place, bar none, is Thousand Islands. That Thousand Islands, Lake Ontario area. If you haven't been there, you owe it to yourself to go. It is a phenomenal place to fish. There's so much diversity there. As you know, Travis, I know you're pretty versed in what goes on there. You have shallow, you have deep, and you could do it all in one day if you wanted to. Mm-hmm. Phenomenal place. Whenever I go there, I kind of break it down the same way. When I'm breaking down we have an FLW tournament. I fished a couple, in all three of those areas, Champlain, Thousand Islands, and Buffalo. And it still breaks down the same way. It's a huge body of water. You can't break down the whole thing in one shot. So if you're going there for a tournament, you have to basically pick an area. And that area, the first thing that I'm going to do when I look at breaking down that body of water is I'm going to look and see what the forecast is. And if the wind direction is coming from a northerly direction, well, I'm probably going to look more at the north end of that lake, especially when it comes to big bodies of water, like Ontario, because it gets so rough.
So you're going to actually look at the weather. You're going to determine based on wind, what are going to be some of the most, accessible places to fish and be able to move around, because I assume you have a lot of plans and ideas and things you want to check out. And as we all know, big waves sometimes make it hard to get from point A to point B. And once you commit to an area, you're pretty much stuck there if you're under some type of heavy winds for that day and you have to kind of stay focused. When you're looking at an upcoming event or a tournament, whether it be on your home body of water, a place that you fish quite a bit, or a body of water you don't get to fish as much, how are you preparing? You mentioned the forecast. Are you doing anything else? Do you get into map study at home? Do you get into things on the computer? Do you look at fishing reports? What goes through your mind when you're preparing for an event?
So number one is going to be the weather forecast, because that's going to dictate where you can fish. If you have high winds, of course, it's going to eliminate certain parts of the lake. The Toyota Series, for instance, it was 2 years ago now. We had two of them here on Erie. And the first one that went out of Sandusky Bay, I saw we had a strong northwest forecast. And I knew the islands area, it had been fishing tough. And I knew that if I made a run to the far west side of the lake, well, I'm looking at calm water, I'm going to play hell, excuse my French, to get there. But I knew if I could get there, I'm going to catch them. And so that's kind of part of what goes into it. The other part is the timing of the year. You're looking at the spawn. Are you dealing with bed fishing? Are you dealing with a post spawn where you're kind of more onesie twosie fishing? You're not dealing with as much of a big school when you're fishing post spawn, because those smallmouths tend to get in a little bit of a funk afterwards, and you can catch those big females kind of roaming by themselves. So there's a lot that goes into this.
As far as technology, we talked a little bit about graphs and utilizing GPS, and back in the day, starting out and gradually seeing all the different changes. How are you utilizing your electronics today? And what type of setup do you run currently?
Currently, I'm running Lowrance. I have Lowrance on the bow and I have it at the console. I'm doing everything from 2D, side imaging, forward view. I have a Garmin for my forward view right now, which I'll probably be switching over to Lowrance just so I can link everything and see everything from the console. Mm-hmm. If I want to idle around and get a good look at an area from behind my console, I can do that. So pretty much a little bit of everything.
When you're idling around looking and utilizing those electronics, are you looking at structure? Are you looking for fish? What's your basic plan when it comes to what you're looking for out there deep and how you have your electronics set up when you're doing that?
So basically, if I'm heading to a new body of water, I don't do it as much now on my home bodies of water, because I've been over most of it a thousand times, it seems like. But like when you go to Buffalo, last time I was there, I will get at idle speed and I'll get it to where I can just be on plane. And that 2D, you see so much. It seems like it's very subtle. When you're idling over it slowly, it doesn't stand out and pop to you. When you're idling or when you're running over it, you see a jump, a 1 foot change. It happens so fast. And I immediately stop and then I'll go over and I'll side image it. And if I see the things I like side imaging, I'm going to drop that trolling motor down and I'm going to take a look with the live scope.
Take a closer look.
Yeah. The live scope has been pretty remarkable in the way that, you know, things, areas that I thought I was pretty intimate with, I was shocked when I went back with live scope. And, you know, of course, everybody knows live scope is phenomenal for seeing fish. But what it taught me more than seeing fish is the fact that you can see exactly where gravel turns to rock and where rock turns to sand. You can see that some, you know, obviously you can see it when you're idling over, but when you're looking forward, man, you just can't see that. And being able to see that ahead of you and seeing a fish where he is in that transition, it tees you off exactly to what you need to be looking for.
What are you looking for when you see those transitions on there? Is it a color change? Is there a specific color palette that you like that allows that to pop out a little bit more? I just want to dig briefly a little bit into that.
Yeah, the screen that I'm using is the blue screen. I don't know what they call it, but it has the blue and everything pops for me in that blue screen. That's on the Garmin presently. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I'm really looking for changes in the bottom. Where you see it go from a smooth bottom, you can pick up where the gravel is. It gets a little bit of a roughness to it. Right. And when it goes into the chunk rock, and of course you can't mistake a boulder. In the past, you know, we had a boulder marked, and it may take you 2, 3, maybe 4 casts to get it to pass through that boulder correctly. You know, nowadays it's a matter of looking at that live scope and it's instant. You know whether your cast was far enough or, you know, whether you missed it by 2 feet.
Sure. Those magic boulders, man. I wish I knew where everyone was, but it seems like whenever you put the time in, and a lot of that's what makes people successful when it comes to smallmouth fishing is putting the seat time in and doing that idling and searching for boulders, for transitions, for things like that. What's one of your like number one types of pieces of structure that you see that you notice in the past consistently hold fish?
It is boulders. Yeah. There are several things, of course, you know, and every area is different. It really depends what side of the lake you're on. When you're on the Michigan side, you know, they're not always on boulders because there aren't a whole lot of boulders on that side. There is a little bit of vegetation out there on the Michigan side, but the vegetation has really changed as well because of we've really been struggling with algae. And that algae growth across the surface has killed, you know, the light being able to have our vegetation grow. So that has pretty much killed a lot of what we used to have going in the past. But I would say number one is probably boulders, boulder fields. Yep.
Have those areas that you said with the algae and changing, does that push the fish away then as well? Like there's places where you've caught them in the past, they just don't show up anymore? Or do they still show up from time to time and just not as consistent?
They are completely gone, and it's because there's no vegetation. Even at its very best, I've had some places where I've won some FLW tournaments. They don't go there anymore because there's no vegetation. It's basically, you know, muck bottom now. The vegetation held the shad, and once that was gone, the areas were history. I keep keeping my fingers crossed that our algae gets taken care of and we can get back to having some weed growth here.
So when you're out there fishing and you're looking for structure, you're looking for new places to fish, I assume just like everyone else, you're trying to find something different, something that you haven't fished before. You mentioned you don't do a lot of idling and looking like you used to on some of the places you're really familiar with. How are you going to locate where that winning bag of fish could potentially be? When you're near a situation where you know the lake really well, you know where the boulders are, you know the structure, how are you going about checking those spots before a tournament?
I'll check every place that I have. I'll idle it. If I don't see fish, I don't fish there. I keep covering water until I see them. Once I see them, then I'll drop the trolling motor and fish. But our electronics are so good nowadays, it eliminates so much time. Whereas in the past, you had to drop a trolling motor and drop a line and see.
What would be your favorite technique to catch smallmouth with?
That is so hard to say. Travis, I've been fortunate enough to win doing a lot of different things. I've had some where it's been spinnerbait, cranking. My favorite, I would have to say, is probably cranking. I probably drop shot more than anything else just because it seems like there's always a drop shot bite. And the crankbait bite, it's very situational. If you have wind that blows for a couple days at a time, it seems like that pretty much kills your cranking bite, unless you are catching them extremely deep. But if I had to pick and choose, it'd probably be cranking.
So you're saying if you had consistent wind, that kills the crankbait bite for you?
It does. Yep. It makes it too turbulent, and it runs those fish right out of the shallower water. And when I say shallow, I'm talking probably 15 and less. Yeah, if it blows hard, no. I'm saying if we have 18-plus mile an hour wind, that is going to kill my cranking bite.
You're relatively shallow when you're talking cranking. Is this something that you utilize throughout the whole season?
So the cranking probably starts, I will say, in July. They have to get past their post-spawn. Once those fish get schooled up again, it seems like I'm starting to catch them shallow. And when I say that, that could be Lake Erie, Detroit River, St. Clair. It's all kind of, I'm putting that all in the same basket. Right. They have to definitely be past the post-spawn for me. A lot of it's just covering water. You've got to cover past history. You got to cover all your rock piles. They're never everywhere. As you know, mm-hmm. 90% of the fish are in 10% of the water. So you have to cover water to a point where I don't sit any place for long. If I'm not getting bit right away, I'm up and I'm gone to the next area. But it's all rock piles, gravel patches. We do have some eelgrass that grows, and you would be surprised what gets in that eelgrass.
Interesting. What's your favorite crankbait?
Okay. Norman Deep Little Inn, Strike King Series 5 and 6. You know, it's tough to beat those, the XD series. Mm-hmm. Also, the DT line, Rapala's DT line, anywhere from a DT 10 to as deep as a 16, depending how deep we're fishing. But, yeah, those are some of my favorites for sure. So I'm a Loomis guy, and Loomis's crankbait line has worked phenomenal for me for my whole life. And that's pretty much what I stick with. You definitely need a very parabolic rod. If you have a stiff rod, you don't have enough bend. It's a little bit of I'll call it the fly rod effect. If you don't have enough rod there to, when that fish jumps, there's so much power in their head shake. If you don't have enough rod there to absorb some of that shock, you're going to lose him. He's going to pull it free. Mm-hmm. But a good parabolic rod that has a lot of bend to it, that will help you tremendously.
So, Mike, you've had a lot of success when it comes to fishing tournaments. What do you think makes you so successful when it comes to doing well in events? Because there's a lot of great anglers. And to consistently be at the top, there's got to be something you're doing different. What do you think that is?
So I think it's probably a number of things. I'm pretty passionate about what I do. I'm pretty intense. most guys that know me, I'm pretty mild-mannered and you know, mostly quiet on the outside, but inside, my wheels are always turning. Whether it's practice, I treat a practice day like I do a tournament day. You know, I'm very intense, and I put in a lot of time at it. I would say the number one factor is probably the amount of time that I put in the water. But you have to always be thinking, and you got to think. I like to play pool, and in billiards, you have to think several moves ahead. When it comes to tournaments, that's going through my mind constantly. It's usually going through my mind as I'm running to a spot. If they're not there, what am I going to do next? I've usually got plan B, plan C. It's usually always in the works. And I think that it's probably a key. Most guys, Kevin's a friend, Steve's a friend. Everybody, I'll put them in the same basket, as in their intensity level is a different level than 99% of guys. And I think that's kind of the same with myself. You're so intense about what you're doing, you're able to look ahead and pick up on things or changes that are happening. Whereas the average Joe might say, okay, I'm going to go to this spot and it's where I'm fishing today. Mm-hmm. Most guys that are successful, they don't treat it that way. They treat it as, okay, let the water tell me what's going to happen. And mm-hmm. I'll read everything that I'm seeing in the water and I'll let that make my next move. And that's probably key. You know, it goes a long way into success, I think.
Yeah, very good advice. Having multiple plans, A, B, and C, because a lot of times, I don't know about you, but A and B just doesn't turn out as you expect often.
Sometimes C and D doesn't turn out either.
No, that's the problem with chasing these fish. So what do you do in that case when you're struggling out there? I know there's a lot of the guys we've had and some of the top smallmouth anglers, they really stay focused throughout the day, even at 11 o'clock when you don't have a fish. What goes through your mind at 10, 11 when things are not going?
Oh, you get frustrated. Right? There's no doubt. But it's how you handle that frustration that probably separates whether you're going to have a successful day or you're going to go back to the weigh-in with nothing. I go for the gold every time. Every tournament, it doesn't matter what it is. I'm not there for points in any of the circuits I fish. I'm there to win, and I try to treat every day that way. So if I'm not around the type fish or the correct fish, you know, that'll be a 4 to 5 pound fish. If I'm not around those fish, I know I have to move. Even if I'm catching a lot of them, you know, the 4 to 5 pound fish are really the fish you're looking for to have any kind of success.
What's your experience over the years as far as doing well consistently in events, whether it be a win or a top, you know, top five or top 10, as far as areas and spots, have you been able to consistently go to the same place and put together a good bag, or are you constantly having to move around and look, you know, new areas to be successful at tournament fishing?
Yeah, it's a constant change. You know, Steve's a close friend of mine, Steve Clapper. We've had this conversation on many, many occasions where we've got areas we haven't caught bass in probably 15 years, where starting out, you know, was phenomenal. There's just so many factors around the islands. I'm going to throw cormorants in there. The cormorants around some of the islands have destroyed the fishing to a point where we don't catch them there anymore. When the cormorants got so thick, the bass would still breed, but I think every single fry that was in the area was getting eaten. And, you know, Steve and I, we kept seeing our bass were getting bigger and bigger there, but we were never seeing no young. And we know it's a matter of them not being there because they're dead. They're in the bellies of the cormorants, you know. So it's slowly getting a little bit better. Places like East Sister Island, you know, East Sister used to be really good. And they haven't been there, and it's been a lot of years now. And it's 100% because of the number of cormorants that are out there.
Yeah.
It'll allow them to grow. Our fish have become so pneumatic. It used to be if we found a fish on a reef or a series of rock piles, they're going to be there for, we'll say, weeks and sometimes more. Anymore, our fish are so pneumatic following bait that I think there's times like I fished a BFL this past year, this super tournament, and I caught them really good on a deep piece of structure. Whereas just weeks prior to it, there was nothing there. It was chock full of sheephead. And I think what changed is I think the bait got there. It was loaded with shad when I went back and checked it before the tournament. And I think the bass just simply follow them around. And once that shad gets loaded up on a piece of structure, then the bass move in.
Wow. Very interesting. So I got a bunch of more questions. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back.
You're listening to the Smallmouth Crush Podcast. Don't rush out to the water just yet. We'll be right back after this break.
Hey, I teamed up with Beast Coast Fishing to design this killer little jig. Whether you're fishing for smallmouth, largemouth, even spotted bass, this thing is sneaky. Designed with proven fish catching characteristics, it's a tiny little finesse football jig. It's called the Open Water Sniper. Of course, it's Smallmouth Crush approved. They come in a wide variety of different colors. This one here is sexy melon. We got Mothman, straight black, green pumpkins. So you notice they actually have a few less strands than your standard football jig. No weed guard. You're going to be throwing this the same place you're going to throw an open water, say, exposed hook tube. So anytime you're around that type of structure, it's going to work real well in rocks, hard bottom. And all you're going to be doing is dragging this along. You can do a drag and stop, a continuous retrieve. You can put a little tiny swim bait on the back of that. There's so many different ways you can fish this jig. I've put a TRD on the back of it and looked at them on the graph and dropped straight down and just let it sit there. They're going to hit it. They're going to bite it. The whole point of this jig is to actually emphasize the trailer that you're going to use. So notice the small strands. The hook is very stout. It's perfect. It's got an awesome keeper for your plastics. I've caught so many fish on this year. It will put more fish in the boat. Go check them out. Hey, listen, they got a lot of other great products as well. BeastCoastFishing.com and pick yourself up the OW, Open Water Sniper Jig, Smallmouth Crush approved. So a bunch more questions for you, Mike. When it comes to tournament fishing, you said you use a lot of different techniques. You mentioned drop shots, you mentioned cranks, you mentioned spinner baits. What are some sneaky things that you use that we need to know about?
Those sneaky things. Let me think about this a little bit.
There's got to be a couple.
Yeah, spy bait. A buddy of mine and I had a 30-pound stringer a couple years ago here out on Lake Erie, and we threw a spy bait in 26 foot of water. I'm betting there's probably not too many guys that throw a spy bait in 26 foot of water. But yeah. Two of the biggest bass we had in that stringer came on a spy bait. So that, I guess you could say that's a little bit of it's a sneaky thing.
So obviously the spy baits come on strong over the last number of years. And I think it really got its start in that region, right? Lake St. Clair and in that zone, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, I would say so. Yeah, there's a lot of guys here having a lot of success, especially Lake St. Clair. I can't say that I've talked to anyone on Erie that's had, you know, good success with it as we have, because I think Erie for most of the year doesn't lend itself water clarity wise to a spy bait. You know, I think it's something that has to definitely be, maybe not gin clear, but you've got to at least have 4 or 5 foot of visibility, because I think the bass come from so far to pick it up.
Of all the techniques that are out there to catch smallmouth, what's one you just hate having to use, but you know it's effective?
Hate having to use. You know, I love catching them this way, but it's probably the number one bait to lose them on, and that's a rattle trap. I've weighed in a ton of fish in FLW on a rattle trap, but of all of them, you know, it's 100%. It's the toughest one to keep them buttoned up on, especially when you're dealing with big schools. You know, a lot of times in the fall, I'm dealing with fish that are, you know, there's probably anywhere from a dozen to 50 fish in a school. And whenever they're schooled up that heavy, they don't eat the bait. They slash at a bait. Mm-hmm. And because there's so many chasing it, they don't get a good bite on it. They don't swallow it. So I think a lot of them end up catching in the side of the face, and you know what happens when they jump. It's tough to hold them on.
You mentioned the lipless and the fact that you've weighed in quite a few fish on that. Is that something you're going to throw year-round as well? And
I
what
do.
Type of situations are you looking for to throw a lipless?
I'm looking at water that's probably 10 foot or less. Maybe 12 foot given the right situation, but it's typically 10 or less. And it's not necessarily a fall thing. I'll do it in the springtime as well. Yeah, summertime, there's been tournaments that I've caught them, you know, relatively shallow on it.
Is the bait and swim bait, I mean, does that come into play for you?
Yeah, it sure does. I love that swim bait. That swim bait in deep structure, you know, that's tough to beat, deep or shallow.
So how do you go about knowing or choosing the perfect bait? There's so many, right? We just mentioned a bunch that would probably do its job. For me, when I'm up shallow and searching, I love a big spinner bait and burning that. Or I'll slow it down with some type of finesse swim bait. What goes through your mind in those situations?
So basically, it's usually practice driven. You know, I'll throw something in practice that I can cover a lot of water with effectively. And that's probably why the rattle trap comes in so much. And if I get in an area where I catch them, that's when I break it down. You know, I'm going to see, is there a spinner bait bite, a swim bait bite? Do I have to snap a tube to get them to bite? It all depends. But practicing is usually on that trap. So I guess the fact that they'd like to throw that trap isn't a bad thing when it's practice, because you're not having to bring that fish to the boat then.
Sure,
down, getting back on that piece of structure. The trap is a very good thing for me when it becomes a shallow bite, because I can cover water so fast.
Covering water, yeah. Yeah, it sounds like you're definitely a power fisherman when it comes to that, but you can settle down and obviously focus on some of that deep stuff. You mentioned the swim bait deep. How are you fishing that?
You know, I always let a swim bait hit the bottom, and, you know, it needs to be within, I would say, a foot of the bottom. I'll make a couple cranks on it, and I'll usually kill it, you know, let it hit the bottom again. But, yeah, it's a killer way to catch them.
What is your standard size swim bait that you throw most?
So it all depends on the time of year. A 2.8 during the cold months, and when I say cold months, probably 55 degrees and less, like right now. I caught them the other day. I caught one on a swim bait the other day. Yeah, typically from 55 or less, I'm throwing a 2.8.
Okay.
And then anything more than that, I'm going to a 3.8. pretty much for the bulk of the year. The shad time of the year, I'm throwing a 3.8 for sure.
Yep.
All shad colors. Well, I shouldn't say that. There's times that a dark color works really well. If you've spent much time on the Great Lakes, you'll see that we've got a pretty good population of snakes. And anytime you see a snake, it almost always has a black goby in its mouth.
It does, yes.
So there's times that dark color, it can be a killer color.
It's been a while since I fished, you know, off of, you know, the islands and Pelee and that part of Lake Erie. But you're right. When I remember years ago, you would, and this was my first time ever experience with a snake in the northern part of the country, you know, down south, they're all over the place. But there's right. like snakes in the middle of Lake Erie. And you're like, what in the heck? It's kind of weird, you know, if you're not used to that. But you're right. They all have these big, dark gobies in their mouth.
Yep. So they're not the only ones eating it. Our bass, I think the reason our bass are so big, obviously, is because of the gobies. The growth rate, you know, they have now because of all the protein in the gobies. Yeah, it's pretty neat. The goby, at first, you know, everybody was so, they were so afraid and skeptical what was going to happen because of the introduction of the goby. And as you know, Travis, it's probably been the best thing that's ever happened to the Great Lakes. Our bass have never been as big as they are right now.
How have the weights changed over the years?
So in the early days, I can remember I started fishing FLW tournaments in 2000. And I can remember you had a pretty strong chance of being in the top 10 if you had 15 pounds. The way it is now, if you're out there at the prime time of the year, well, I'm going to give you an example. 3 years ago, I fished a super tournament and I caught just under 23 pounds on day one. And I quit fishing for them and I did not make the cut. And I think the cut was like 16 boats. So that gives you a little bit of an idea, you know, how much things have changed. Yeah. I think the one I won a super tournament here this past year. And I think I weighed 25.8 the one day and 27.6 the next. So that's some of the best stringers I've had.
What time of year was that one?
So that one was in September. Yeah, late September.
Late September. So you had a 26-pound bag?
I had it was 25.8. Wow. And yeah. The day two was 27.6.
27.6. That's crazy. Walk me through that day, man, because that's pretty big to win a super tournament and have two big sacks like that. You had been feeling good, right? What time did you have that weight in the boat by?
I think I had that at like 8:30. Oh, I looked at my call and I said, we're going to have to go here. It's time to practice a little bit more. It was a pretty long run where I was, and it was all deep water. You know, it topped out. The deepest was about 30 foot. It would top out, you know, 26, 24 in some places. In practice, when I slid up to this spot, you know, I threw a drop shot down there and I hooked one, and I'm running a live scope. So I'm watching him come up and I hit spot lock. And he was on a piece of structure where I'd normally catch him. And I took him off. And when I dumped that fish back in the water, I looked forward again. And they're all coming. I'm like, this is crazy. You know, the fish isn't even, they didn't follow the fish in. I'm just looking at the bottom and they're all just kind of coming to my boat. I'm like, oh boy. So I just made one more flip. And the next one, the one I had caught was, I don't know, it was a heavy five. And I pitched one more back in there and I caught a six. And I thought, okay, this wow. this has the potential of being really naughty. And right. I think.
Now, is this a spot you've had success in the past on as
it
well?
It is. Yep. I've it caught is. Them there okay. in the past, but it's never 100%. You know, every yeah. year is different. There's some years they don't show like that. You yeah. know how it is. You know, you pull up to places on Lake Erie anymore and, you know, you could catch like 27 pounds one day and the next day you come, there may not be anything there. It may be sheephead. And that's just kind of what we're dealing with here on Erie. So you've always got to have a plan B or a plan C. Yeah. And basically I went looking for plan D and on down the list. And I didn't end up finding anything, but I did find some fish that I thought, well, you know, if I'm hurting, I can catch them.
Were you leading day one? After
I
that?
Was leading day one. Okay. Yeah, I think Keith was behind me. I think Keith had like almost 23 pounds, another big bag. Mm-hmm. And of course, with Wagner, you know, Heath catches them. You know, you're never safe on that body of water. We have so many tremendous fishermen that are fishing that circuit. you know, between Rhodey and of course Dobson always catches them, and Heath and Steve, even Steve up in his years, you know, you never know when Steve's going to pull out.
We've had all those guys on the podcast. That's crazy. So all the big sticks out there doing battle. You're going into day two now. What were conditions? Were you able to get right back on it?
So both days it blew pretty hard, and it blew out of the north. So we kind of had some crazy conditions. You know, it got pretty rough. And as day two went on, I think by probably 10, 11 o'clock, I knew I had, you know, if I was going to get beat, Heath would have to have a gigantic stringer. You know, he would have to have one of his 29-pound stringers that he had. But I just kind of played the odds, and I didn't weigh anything. I just knew that everything I had was over 5 pounds. I figured I had what I needed, and I started going to work for my co-angler and, you know, pointing fish out for him. And he ended up catching 3 giants there. Yeah, the wind started kicking up then, and I kind of gave him the choice. I've got other places where I know he can catch, you know, 2 more fish to finish your limit off. But, or we can stay here in the wind, and it wasn't fast and furious. So you can either grind it out here, or we can work our way back, and I think we can finish your limit off and you know, hopefully get a W for both of us here. He made the choice. Let's start working our way back, because we were quite a ways away and the wind was kicking up hard. We just started working boulders on our way back, and everything worked out. Nice. And I ended up catching one more real big one that I culled with at the river mouth. So, yeah, you never know.
That's incredible. I love hearing those stories, because you never really get to, especially at that level, you know, if there's elite there, you can kind of, or a big event, you know exactly what those guys did. But it's rare to get that, you know, firsthand experience when you're out there and how everything plays out. So I love those types of stories, man. That's pretty cool. What's one of your most memorable wins that you've had?
I would say I won a super tournament. It would have been in 2009, I think. And that one was pretty neat. I weighed in 26.15 on the final day of that one. And I was actually in third place. I actually felt kind of bad. There were 2 guys in front of me. Heath was in front of me. And Ryan said, I think he was leading. Ryan had 2 tremendous bags for both days, but I happened to catch 26.15 the second day and had to play spoiler. You feel bad. You feel bad for it, but you know, you're still working hard to win, you know?
Sure. Yeah,
but it was cool. That was probably the most memorable. I remember when I weighed my fish that day. I weighed my 5th fish, and my scale said, like, you know, on my scale, it was 26.10. And I sat down, and I just shook. It was like I just pulled a big buck, you know. You always get that feeling after I shoot a big deer. And I just shook. I was like, holy cow, you know. And that was back 2009. We really didn't see those kinds of weights back then. Now, there's been so many tournaments between then and now where, Travis, I thought that I had what we needed to win, you know, and you know as well as I do, tournament fishing does not work that way. You have to deal with what you're given for the day. And anymore, you know, you don't know going into it, you could have a tremendous practice. It doesn't pan out that way.
All right, well, we come to the part of the podcast where I ask everybody these same 2 questions. First of all, I want to know, what's your biggest smallmouth on that body of water, your personal best, and give me a little background, little details on how you caught it.
Okay, so I've had 3 that are over 7, and they've all been on Erie. And the biggest one was 7.5. And that fish that I caught, he was kind of we were between spawns. So we'd had the first flight of spawn come in, and they did their thing. And I had a buddy of mine come out with me, and we had a real good time. And I went through an area that typically they would have come and gone from, and it was in like 15 feet. And this happened to be on the Michigan side. And we went through that area, and I fired a cast with a menace on a football head. And anyway, I come through this structure, and it loaded up, and I set the hook. And the water was so clear, I could see him on the bottom in 12-foot water. And that doesn't happen that often in the spring where it's that clear on the Michigan side. And I'm looking at this fish. At first, I didn't think it was a bass. It was so long. I thought, that's got to be a walleye. There's no way. And as it come up to the surface, here it was a bass and ended up weighing 7.5. That thing was a beast.
So I think this is going to be an interesting answer. I'm really curious about this because you are so versatile when it comes to different baits and techniques. And we talked about a lot of different baits that you've done well in the past. So if I was to tell you that this coming season, you're only going to have one bait to throw for smallmouth for the whole season, that's all you can use, what bait is that going to be?
Hands down, that's going to be a swim bait.
Swim bait.
It's going to be a 3/8 Kytec swim bait. And in anything that's shad color. Because that bait, I can catch them from the time the ice melts to the time it gets hard again. Yeah, 100%. That's for me. Yep.
What are some different ways you would fish that?
So, I mean, you could fish it anywhere from shallow to, I've caught them as deep as 30 feet with that. Mm-hmm. You know, you just have to let it get to the bottom and reel it slow to keep it there. Adjust your weight accordingly. There's times that I'll swim it, I'll fish it a little bit like a tube, and you know, I'll hop it up off the bottom because we have so many gobies. You know, the goby doesn't have a swim bladder, and that goby, all of its vertical movements, you know, when it's distressed, when you see one on a camera, when he's distressed, he goes up. All their movements are up. So when you're hopping a tube or you're hopping a swim bait, you know, you're getting that same goby effect.
That's the answer I was looking for, because I know you can definitely catch them just a standard retrieve and slow rolling, whatever. But I love the fact that you're able to take that and fish it almost like you would a tube. I think that's a key that a lot of people don't do or don't take advantage of fishing the swim bait. There's so many different ways to do it.
Yeah, absolutely.
And it's extremely effective. How late in the year do you think you can fish typically?
Till the water's hard.
Yeah.
I'll catch them on it till the water's hard. Nice. We fished one day this past week here, and we had a slow day because we'd had a big blow prior to that, and the water was all chocolate milk. I had one area that was a little bit clear, and I caught one smallmouth there, but the rest were all green ones that we caught. But had it been clear, I could see them. I could see them on my live scope. They just didn't want to bite. Just a little too dirty for them.
And then as far as the springtime, are you out there ice out, ready to go?
Soon as that ice melts, I should say the ramps are the biggest thing. A lot of times your lake's open, but you can't get there because the ramps are closed.
Yeah, right.
Well, the ramps tend to dictate when we can get out there. But we've had a lot of years where, you know, there's still ice on the lake. I can remember running out to Bass Islands one time, and I had a good friend of mine with me, and we started going through ice. And his eyes got about this big. I said, don't worry. We're not going to have any problems here. But, yeah, there was still ice on a lot of the lakes, and we caught them pretty good. Yeah, it was fun.
What techniques are you going to be throwing that time of year with that water still being that cold?
Some of my favorites are a blade. I'm a Vibe guy. I love to throw Vibe for smallmouth. For largemouth, I like to throw a Silver Buddy. I think the Silver Buddy has a little bit more flash to it, but Vibe works very well. I make up my own hair jigs, and usually probably a 3/8 to a 1/2 ounce air jig. That'll always be in the bag of tricks. Anything that's kind of minnow colored, you know, a little subtle, sometimes a white, but typically it'll be something that's a subtle minnow color for me. And then every once in a while you'll catch them on a little craw, you know, that's always a possibility. It really depends when you find them, and I'm sure you know this as well, when you find them in the wintertime, they're stacked usually, and they're not as spread out as they are the rest of the year. I think it's like it's a big magnet. You know, these fish all get drawn into small areas the size of your boat, sometimes smaller than that. And it can be fun, but they're not as easy to find, obviously, because they're not in as much as the water. And you just have to get behind your graph and do some idling.
Real quick, before we let you go, I got to ask you a couple questions about the hair jig, because you're using a little bit heavier sizes. I'm assuming it's more of a bucktail over a marabou at that time of year, or what's your thoughts on that?
Definitely deer hair. And I buy deer tails and from Jan's Netcraft. And then I'll cut them and make my own, glue them up, you know, thread them. And they work pretty good. I'm just kind of getting into the summertime hair jig bite and just trying to learn that a little bit more. I've caught fish on them, caught some really good ones on it, but I wouldn't call myself as versed in the shallow hair jig bite. It's there, and I know it's another thing that needs to be added a little more effectively to the repertoire, if you will.
With that deer hair in the colder water, how are you typically working that bait?
Slow. It's a glide. You know, summertime, I think most of my tubes in that I'm hopping or I'm snapping the tube. Whereas I think when that water gets cold, it's more of a glide. And it's not necessarily keeping it on the bottom as it is maybe within a foot of the bottom. It's got to be close to them when it's that cold. But typically, slow. It's a steady glide across the bottom.
All right, great stuff. Really appreciate you, Mike, coming on and sharing some of your experiences when it comes to tournament fishing. I know you had some great success. I know you'll have continued success in the future. How can people follow, keep up with what you got going on? What are your plans for this coming year?
Well, we'll see. We don't have any of the big tournaments coming here to our area. So I'm going to take a look and see what they have, you know, probably Thousand Islands way. And, you know, we'll see. Maybe I'll head that way. Of course, we always have BFLs here and a lot of good team tournaments and opens that we'll fish, but we'll see.
Right. They used to have so many big events there. And now it's like once or twice a year, if you're lucky.
And I think the closing of Canada kind of hurt that. Now that everything's back open, hopefully they revisit that, and I think they'll be back, I'm sure. It's just a matter of time.
Well, you're always welcome back, and we certainly appreciate the information today, Mike.
Thanks, Travis. Nice talking to you.
Thank you very much, and as always, guys, until next time, we'll see you on the water.
Thanks so much for listening today. Make sure that you're subscribed to the show and follow us on Instagram at Smallmouth Crush. Also, the YouTube channel, Smallmouth Crush. And if you feel so inclined, please leave us a 5-star rating and comment with a review below. And as always, until next time, we'll see you on the water.